Amoni Davis is a professor at a rival school. Yeah, I mean, we're all in the top 10 in clinical programs, okay, just saying. And she is a former head of the public defender here in the District of Columbia. She ran Jesse Jackson's Rainbow Coalition. She's had an amazing, amazing past and history. She's an art professor and a gifted professor who wins, you know, great teaching awards at American. We're honored to have her. Kick us off.
So thanks so much, Shelley. And because she's my dear friend, she knows me by my alias, Amoni. But my other name is Angela Davis, and I, as she said, teach over at AU, and we're not rivals, we're very much friends. So I want to read just a short excerpt from my chapter. Essay which is called There Before the Grace of God Go I. From the moment I started at PDS, I knew it was where I was supposed to be. I spent the first 6 weeks of the job in an intensive training program along with six other lawyers, learning everything from trial advocacy skills to developing a case theory to the ins and outs of the DC Superior Court. Charles Tree Ogletree was a training director for my class. Tree and the other lawyers at PDS made us feel as if we were soldiers in the Army for Justice. By the time the training program was over, I felt like the knight in shining armor on the PDS t-shirts, ready to charge across the street to court and slay anyone and everyone who came between my client and freedom. When I started at PDS in 1982, the first assignment for new lawyers was juvenile court. In my years as a public defender, I never had the least qualm about representing any of my clients, juvenile or adult. It didn't matter what they were charged with, and I never even thought about whether they were innocent or guilty. It didn't matter to me. I was going to represent them with the same zeal and commitment either way. With juvenile clients, I couldn't understand why everyone didn't feel the same way. Can we ever give up on a child? No matter what they may have done, don't we owe it to ourselves to try to rehabilitate a child? I firmly believed that any child could be saved. The juvenile client that had the greatest effect on me was my first, Albert Hicks, that's a pseudonym. Albert was charged with a misdemeanor, a simple assault in which he and two adults were alleged to have gone into the home of an acquaintance and beaten him up. My client said that he had not participated in the assault and had done nothing to help the adult co-defendants. I believed him. I investigated the case thoroughly and worked day and night preparing for trial. We went to trial before the Honorable Gladys Kessler, a tough but fair-minded judge. She found him involved, guilty, seconds after I gave my closing argument. I was devastated. In hindsight, there was no logical reason for me to believe I could possibly obtain an acquittal for Albert. Acquittals by judges are rare, especially in juvenile cases, and our defense theory wasn't the strongest. But I was young and idealistic and maybe a little foolish. I bonded with my client and wanted to free him from the juvenile justice system. With his record, there was a pretty good chance he would end up at Oak Hill. I couldn't help but feel that his conviction, called an adjudication of delinquency, was my failure. It wasn't over. There was still the disposition hearing. I put all my energy into getting the best possible result for Albert. I had my work cut out for me. Albert had a juvenile record a mile long, and I found out that he'd been charged as an adult for an armed robbery in nearby Prince George's County, Maryland, where amazingly he had received a probationary sentence. For some reason, none of this got in the way of my believing Albert's story. In juvenile court, in order to sentence a child, the judge must find that the child committed a delinquent act and that he is in need of care and rehabilitation. If the judge is convinced that the child does not need care and rehabilitation, she may dismiss the case, quote, for social reasons, unquote. If she finds that he is in need of such care and rehabilitation, she may either place him on probation or commit him to the Department of Youth Rehabilitation Services. I decided on an unconventional strategy for the disposition hearing. There was no way Judge Kessler was going to put my client on probation in view of his juvenile and adult record. I decided to file a motion to dismiss for social reasons. This was unusual because these motions were ordinarily filed in cases where the juvenile was a first offender and there was lots of evidence that he was ordinarily a well-behaved, exceptional kid. There would be letters from teachers, pastors, and community members praising the child for his good grades and good works. There was no such evidence in support of dismissal for Albert. Instead, my motion suggested the opposite. argued that because Albert has such a long juvenile record, and now even an adult record, there was really nothing the juvenile system could do. His adult probation would be revoked in Prince George's County, so why send him for a period of incarceration at Oak Hill, where he couldn't be helped anyway? Not surprisingly, Judge Kessler didn't buy it. She committed him to DYRS for a period of 2 years, the maximum sentence he could get. Again, I was devastated, more so than after the trial. There was nothing else I could do for Albert. I tried so hard to get a good result for him, yet I failed him at every step of the process. I told Albert that I was sorry and that I would come to Oak Hill to see him soon. I held it together long enough to make it out of the courtroom. I ran to the restroom where I burst into tears. What kind of lawyer was I anyway? That poor kid relied on me and this was the best I could do. The door of the restroom opened and Mrs. Hicks, Albert's mother, walked in. She came over, hugged me and said, "Miss Davis, don't worry about Albert, he'll be all right." She wasn't crying. I thought, something is wrong with this picture. I should be comforting her. I need to get it together. But I really liked this kid. I didn't care that he had a long record of criminal behavior and had done a lot of bad things. He wasn't a bad person. He was smart and talented and gentle and kind, despite his criminal behavior. There was no excuse for his behavior, but there was definitely an explanation. Albert's family was poor. He'd never known his father, and almost every adult around him was involved in the criminal justice system. As smart as he was, the DC public school system had failed him. Albert's mother did the best she could, but she was a single mother with several other children. Albert had no positive mentors and knew no life other than the one he had. Even though I grew up relatively poor, I had had so many more opportunities. I had parents who were not educated, but who had high standards for their children and worked hard to send us to good schools. I grew up in a racist, segregated town, but I had good role models who instilled in me the value of education as the great equalizer. I had strict parents who made me behave, and I had a big sister who rescued me from the police. That's another part of my essay. Albert had none of these things. There before the grace of God, go I.
All right, David Singleton was a lawyer with the Harlem Neighborhood Defender and the public defender here in D.C., the best public defender in the country. And now he's doing policy. He is the executive director of the Ohio Justice Policy Center, a great lawyer, he has a wonderful reputation, and we're going to hear about some of the policy work. David, great to have you in the house.
Thank you. I do also litigate too. I can't stay away from the courtroom, but we do focus mostly on litigation that has an impact in the criminal justice system in Ohio. And I want to talk with you about some people that I represent, that the center represents, that many would consider to be the ultimate pariahs of our time. And those are people who have been convicted of sex offenses and then made to feel like they're outcasts in the community. I don't like to use the term sex offender because it is a label, and labels allow us to distance people and treat them in all kinds of manner. You will hear me refer to sex offender at some point in my as I read my chapter, but know that that is not something I like to say. I don't like using labels. It was February 2005, and I faced an important decision. 4 years after leaving my position as a staff attorney with the Public Defender Service for the District of Columbia, I was 3 years into my job as the executive director of the Ohio Justice and Policy Center in Cincinnati. The decision I faced, whether or not to challenge Ohio's ban on sex offenders living within 1,000 feet of schools, could repel funders and shutter the struggling organization that I led. The timing could not have been worse. That month, a convicted sex offender abducted Jessica Lunsford, a 9-year-old Florida girl, and buried her alive with her stuffed animals. Horrible, horrible, horrible crime. The murder of young Jessica generated national headlines, igniting a backlash against sex offenders everywhere. I felt torn between my public defender instincts, which urged challenging the residency restriction, and the fear expressed by some OJPC board members that taking such a controversial case could be organizational suicide. As we came closer to making a decision about taking the case, the reality that I was no longer a public defender hit me. As executive director of an organization with a broad mission, I had to consider not only the the needs of our clients, but also the interest of OJPC. The question was not whether our clients had a need, but whether we should take the case if doing so could jeopardize our organization. Unsure, I decided to talk with two board members. One of them, a dear friend, told me what I knew but did not want to hear. The case could put the organization at risk. For better or worse, he warned, taking this case could be our Skokie moment, referring to the American Civil Liberties Union's loss of support because of its high-profile representation of Nazis who wanted to march to the village of Skokie, Illinois, where one in six residents was a Holocaust survivor. This board member didn't tell me not to take the case, but he told me that taking it, if we took it, we should do so with awareness of what it could mean for the organization. But then I spoke to our founder, a man named Al Gerhardstein, who was our board chair. "Go for it," he said. That was all I needed to hear. Perhaps I should have involved the board in a deeper discussion, but I was more interested in the result, being able to justify filing the case, than I was in the process. So on February 25, 2005, with the most influential member of our board supporting us, we filed a suit in federal district court in Cincinnati. And we asked for an immediate TRO to halt the resident restriction from going into effect. Now my chapter then goes, I'm gonna pick up with the ending, but the chapter then goes into how we got our asses kicked at first. We got destroyed, not only in the courts, but in the court of public opinion. We were focused too much in how we frame the case on our clients' rights, as opposed to framing the issues in terms of how this law actually didn't keep anybody safe, and to surprise some of you, actually made the community less safe. That's how we changed our message, and we then won. We won in the federal district court on an ex post facto claim, and then won an amazing result in the Ohio Supreme Court, where we basically got a court to rule that a statute that clearly was meant to be retroactive did not apply retroactively, and we did that by aligning with public safety groups and victims' rights groups and the like to change the conversation. So that's what the chapter talks about. Let me close it. When we began our sex offender work, many people predicted we would fail. Fortunately, we did not. Instead of drying up, PC's funding grew. In 2002, our budget was $300,000. Today, it's a little under $1 million. We have 13 full-time employees today compared with before we had when we filed suit in 2005. We have also grown in prestige and influence, although there were some who predicted we would forever be known as those wackos who represent sex offenders. We've become well-respected locally and statewide across a broad array of criminal justice issues. For 2 years, we fought for the most despised people in our state. We refused to give up on them when it looked like we would never win. We risked our very existence because we believed in our clients' humanity despite the seriousness of their crimes. We gave them representation better than money could buy. Our challenge to the resident restriction is among the work I'm most proud of doing in my entire legal career. Whenever I give community presentations about OJPC, invariably someone asks how I could represent sex offenders, particularly those who harm children. Although I used to answer by explaining how our advocacy improved public safety along the lines of what I was telling you a minute ago, that explanation is not entirely true. The reason I come to work every day is not to make the community safer, but to be the voice of clients others would rather ignore. So now I talk about how my faith has emboldened me to serve people others might reject. I think advocacy on behalf of people in the criminal justice system is the kind of work that Jesus would embrace. But to me, faith is much broader than any set of religious teachings. It's about doing what's right, even when you have doubts about whether you will succeed. As Martin Luther King Jr. said, faith is taking the first step, even when you don't see the entire staircase. Although there were times during the residency restriction litigation that I thought we would never win, we kept going because it was the right thing to do. What also kept me going after the early losses was my belief in the possibility of redemption. We all make mistakes, sometimes bad mistakes. My own desire not to be defined by my worst moments allowed me to feel empathy for sex offenders I represented. I believe that everybody is capable of changing for the better, if only in small ways. Not always big ways, but sometimes very small ones. That's what I now say when I'm asked how I could represent sex offenders.
Fabulous. Vida Johnson is a visiting associate professor at Georgetown University Law Center, comma, a rival school. She was an Ebert Friedman fellow there, and which is a program that Abby directs or co-directs. And she went on to the public defender for many, many, many years, eight, I think, slugging it out in major felonies and doing this work. And she's had some absolutely amazing cases, and is a gifted professor also, and I'm delighted to have her. Vida?
Thank you. Thanks everyone for having me. I'm going to read to you from the beginning of my chapter, and I'm going to skip ahead a little bit. So if you want to know what's in between, you'll have to read.
And we have books available.
Late one fall night in 1967, a group of men placed a bomb under the floor of a parsonage connected to the St. Paul's United Methodist Church in Laurel, Mississippi. The men then moved a safe distance away and lit the fuse. The bomb exploded, and the kitchen and dining room were blown apart. That parsonage was the home of my maternal grandfather. My grandfather, Dr. Reverend Alan Johnson, was a pastor of St. Paul's United Methodist. When the bomb exploded, he, my grandmother, and their three of their children were asleep. Miraculously, the bedrooms where they were sleeping were not seriously damaged, and no one was hurt. My grandfather and his family were targeted because they were African American, and because my grandfather was a leader in the civil rights movement. He was active in the NAACP, and a member of the Voters League. My grandparents, however, did not waver in the face of violence. Indeed, the morning after the bombing, my grandmother sent her children to school that day so that everyone would know that the Johnson family was not intimidated. The policies of mass incarceration and overcriminalization of the African American community threatened so much of what my grandparents and their colleagues fought for. The right to vote, equal representation in government, and equal employment opportunity. While not overtly based on race, the racialized enforcement of our criminal justice policies leads to the same result. Employers may not explicitly refuse employment on the basis of race. Instead, they use criminal records as a basis for denying or ending employment. Like Jim Crow, our current criminal justice regime virtually ensures that Black Americans have higher rates of unemployment and poverty, fewer and worse educational opportunities, and underrepresentation in democratic institutions. Disturbingly, but yet not coincidentally, this process of mass incarceration and criminalization began in the mid-1970s, when the civil rights movement had begun to accomplish so many of its objectives. When I enter a courtroom to represent an indigent defendant, I am fighting against the same double standards, the same inequities, and the same unfairness that my grandparents fought against. The battle remains the same, only the battlefield has changed. In fact, the subject of this book, How Can You Represent Those People, highlights one very significant way in which the battlefield has changed. Unequal treatment based on criminalization rather than race has eliminated the moral authority of those who fight against unequal treatment. Where blatant discrimination based on race is now morally repugnant to most Americans, this is not so for unequal treatment of people who have been charged or convicted of crimes. Indeed, most Americans seem to believe that people with criminal records should be denied rights and opportunities. Efforts to garner public support for change through boycotts, marches, or protests are unlikely to succeed. There are, however, ways to fight for some measure of equality. One of them is to make sure when the police or prosecutors try to convict a person of a crime and put him or her in prison, that person has a lawyer who will use every legal means to stop them, or at least hold them to the very high burden of proof required in criminal cases. To me, the question is not how can I represent those people, but how can I not?
a checkered past too. She was a public defender in Philadelphia. She's taught at other rival schools, from CUNY, a real rival, to Georgetown and Temple. And she's written countless books and countless law review articles. She wrote a great book I highly recommend called Case of a Lifetime, for example. I hope you'll go buy that next, right after tonight. You can buy this one here. You owe me. She is someone who is teaching Prettyman Fellows and third-year Georgetown Law Fellows all day, every day, to carry this work on, and that's one of the greatest places to learn how to do this work, and she's one of the very best there is, and a dear friend. So I'm delighted to have you, Abbe.
Thanks so much. I do owe you because of the generosity that you and your colleagues at the University of the District of Columbia, David A. Clark School of Law, have shown in having us here, so thank you so much.
Give yourselves a hand, UDC. Yeah.
And I just wanted to say, in case you couldn't tell from the look on my face when the others were reading, I'm really proud of this book, and frankly feel privileged to share its pages with Angela, David, Vida, and the other contributing authors. I like guilty people. I do. I can't help myself. I prefer people who are flawed and complicated and do bad things to those who are irreproachable and uncomplicated and do the right thing. Flawed people are more interesting. Take, for example, a recent client I'll call Renee Cooper. Ms. Cooper was African American in her mid-50s, obese, toothless, and always fretting about something: how she would get to court, how she would get to the mental health clinic, the long lines at drug testing, various family problems. Ms. Cooper had been in and out of trouble much of her life. She had a long sheet consisting mostly of petty offenses like drug possession and prostitution, but she had also done time for selling drugs. She was doing well on parole when she caught a new prostitution charge. The facts of the case were memorable and not in dispute. Ms. Cooper had offered to perform oral sex on an undercover police officer in exchange for fried chicken. Ms. Cooper was only slightly humiliated to have been arrested under these circumstances. As far as she was concerned, she was hungry, and a blowjob in exchange for dinner was not a bad trade. But the arrest was a problem. It was a violation of her parole and meant she had to go to court on the new case. We tried hard to get her to complete a mental health diversionary program, a therapeutic, treatment-oriented alternative to criminal prosecution, so that Ms. Cooper might avoid a new conviction and parole violation. But she missed meetings, tested positive for drugs, or water-loaded before testing, and otherwise failed to comply with the requirements of diversion. So the mental health court judge put her back on the regular criminal calendar. This was not a triable case, and Ms. Cooper knew it. Her plan was to plead guilty and throw herself on the mercy of the court. She did not want to go to jail. By some miracle, her parole officer took pity on her and did not violate her for the new crime. So the only thing we had to worry about was whether the judge before whom Ms. Cooper was scheduled to appear would send her to jail for doing something as desperate as offering a blowjob for fried chicken, assuming she was going to continue to test dirty or otherwise fall short on pretrial release. I got a kick out of Ms. Cooper. She always greeted me with a big bear hug. She called me Miss Abbe. She was funny and charming. She said she had heard of me, that I was known as a great lawyer. I doubted this. Let me try to explain what I mean when I say I like guilty people. I don't mean to be glib. Of course, there are crimes so cruel and depraved they turn my stomach. I think of child abduction, captivity, rape cases, certain hate crime, and cases featuring gratuitous meanness and violence. It is hard not to feel for the victims. It is hard not to feel revulsion toward the perpetrators. When I say I like guilty people, I mean the vast majority of my clients who have committed crimes for a variety of reasons, but who are not evil. This may be what every defender says. My clients aren't wicked, but damaged, deprived, or in distress. The reasons for their criminal conduct are both complex and simple. Growing up in abusive or neglectful homes, falling prey to drugs or alcohol or gangs, being young and impetuous and lacking in judgment and resources, having cognitive or mental health problems, losing control in a moment of rage, making bad choices in a bad moment. For the most part, my clients feel remorseful and ashamed, at least by the time they get to sentencing. If they don't or can't feel remorse, it is generally not a matter of character, but conditions and context. As famed criminal lawyer Clarence Darrow said, we are all poor, blind creatures bound hand and foot by the invisible chains of heredity and environment, doing pretty much what we have to do in a barbarous and cruel world. That's about all there is to any court case. Ms. Cooper, the woman accused of prostitution, was ultimately placed on probation, notwithstanding her less than perfect performance on pretrial release. The judge said the important thing was she had no new arrests. I think I wasn't the only one charmed by Ms. Cooper. Do I have time for one more story? Okay. The opportunity to challenge authority on behalf of another and the duty to do so is oddly freeing. It doesn't feel that way on my own behalf. Then I fold like a cheap tent. But for a client, I'm easily indignant. I tone it down because those feelings are not necessarily effective advocacy. But I'm happy to take on virtually anyone for a client. When I visited Ronnie, a long-serving prisoner, for the very first time, I did the usual due diligence. I'd never been to this prison before and wanted no problem getting in. Every prison has its own rules and regulations. Some have limited hours. Some don't let you wear certain clothing or colors. Some don't allow you to give anything to or receive anything from prisoners, even legal documents. I was from out of state and wanted to make sure my bar card would be honored. The fellow and I got to the prison, about an hour and a half away, on a Friday morning of a holiday weekend. We got there early because my son was playing in a baseball tournament later that day, which I wanted to attend. When we walked into the outer room of the visiting area, everything looked as it should, except for one thing. Taped to the metal detector was a flyer that read in large capital letters the following: you will receive two attempts to pass through the metal detector machine. If you do not clear the machine, you will be prohibited from visiting. Now, here was the problem. I was wearing an underwire bra. This sometimes sets off metal detectors. Now, I was perfectly prepared to be wanded, to have one of the corrections officers use a handheld detecting wand or a hand searched if the detector signaled the presence of metal. This is what happens in court and other jails and prisons, but I'd never encountered a jail or prison that relied entirely on a machine. Frankly, my dental work might set them off. I shared my concern with the corrections officer in charge of the visiting room. I told the officer that I had contacted the warden and asked whether there was anything unusual about getting into this prison and had not been told anything about this metal detector rule. The corrections officer said that, in fact, the flyer typed to the machine was wrong and visitors were entitled to only one pass. And if it went off, the visitor would be prohibited from entering the prison. I asked to see a supervisor. While I was waiting, a large, heavily tattooed woman in her 30s and her six-year-old daughter arrived in the visiting area. They were coming to see the woman's fiancé. In jails, prisons, and courthouses, everyone is suddenly a fiancé. An older woman was with them, maybe the fiancé's mother. The little girl and older woman sailed through the metal detector with no problem, but it went off when the tattooed woman went through. She protested that she had no metal on her of any kind and had driven 4 hours to get there. The officer in charge was unmoved and said she would not be allowed in. The woman sat down and wept. After a few minutes, she whimpered, "Please, please let me in." The officer ignored her. She wept some more and repeated her plea for admittance. The crying and begging went on for some time. It was distressing to me, but seemed to have no effect on the officer. Eventually, a supervisor came. She said I might be getting worked up for no reason and suggested I remove the jewelry I had on, a couple of silver rings, some small silver earrings, and see what happens. She said the other officer was wrong about getting only one try, that I was entitled to two times through, just like the flyer said. Okay, I said, and did it as she suggested. But the machine buzzed when I walked through. I turned to the supervisor. What now? I asked. You're not getting in with that bra, she said. So I walked out to the parking lot, took my bra off to the enjoyment of the man sitting in the car next to mine, and threw it in my trunk. Then I walked back to the visiting area. I was met by the fellow who had accompanied me. You won't believe this, he said. What? I said. He looked like he didn't want to tell me. Now they're not going to let you in because you're not wearing proper undergarments. You can't make this stuff up. I walked back into the visiting area. I wanted to say any number of things, but the only sign as prominent as the one on the metal detector was one that read, again in large capital letters, any profanity or abusive language directed at correction staff will result in the permanent loss of visiting privileges. So I held my tongue. I asked whether they were trying to humiliate me. I asked to see another supervisor and then another. I would have left, except that Ronnie was expecting us. He hadn't seen a lawyer in 25 years. I couldn't bear to disappoint him. Eventually we got in to see him. I was hopelessly late to my son's tournament. Worse still were the conditions of the visit. Legal visits at this particular prison were conducted by telephone in a booth with a plexiglass screen between the prisoner and attorney. There was no physical contact whatsoever. I don't know why my bra was so important under these circumstances. But it's a good story, and it makes the point about how defenders have to constantly take on authority. It's also a sobering lesson about prisons. If this is how corrections officers treat 50-year-old lawyers, and they also knew I was a law professor, imagine how they treat people on the inside. My clients don't stand a chance. Thanks.
Fabulous stories. We're going to ask a few questions, and then we're going to turn it over to you to do the really roughing up. Starting with you, Amani, what are the most difficult cases for you to defend? Or difficult case and why?
So this really isn't, you know, I'm not being glib and I'm not trying to be, and I hope people don't think less of me, but it really, really, really does not matter to me at all. I mean, I represented people, not cases. That's how I saw it. You know, I would meet my client, this is a human being, and it really didn't matter to me what they did, what they were alleged to have done. Because, you know, the way I saw it was, it's me and I'm all that client has. The government's against them, the police are against them, the community's against them, sometimes their own family's against them. And I've just always been the kind of person who wants to stand up for the underdog. There's nobody that's more of an underdog than our clients. And so I really took a lot of pride in being able to say, I'm for you. You know, I don't care what the rest of the world is saying, it doesn't matter. I'm going to be here for you, and I'm going to represent you. I don't care whether you did it or not. My job is to find the best defense possible for you, and if we can't find that, there's no defense to get the best possible result for you. And I took a lot of pride in that. I'm not trying to, like, not answer your question. That's my honest answer. I represented people, not crimes, and that's the way I always saw it.
David?
I've got a similar answer. I'm going to try and say it a little differently, though. I don't like serious crime. I don't like rape. I've got, or any kind of sexual events, just because I know that's a hot button for a lot of people. I've got a wife I adore and a daughter that I adore. I don't like when crime impacts and hurts people in the community. But I find something, and this is not going to be true for every person who does this work, but I've been able to find something to like, I think in every single client that I've represented, every single one of them. Does that mean I've been the best of friends with all my clients? Absolutely not. Have some clients gotten under my skin? Yeah, sure. Usually because I didn't follow through on something I said I was going to do, and they're in a really tough spot, and of course they get mad if you're supposed to be at the jail the day before, and you show up the day after. But I really have really learned to not write off and to see something good in everybody. One of my favorite clients I actually talk about in my chapter, and he had committed a rape when he was under the influence of alcohol and drugs. And it turns out he was in the Aryan Brotherhood when he was in prison. And I show up as this black dude, and his daughter trying to keep him from being evicted from his home. I actually didn't know that about him until later, about the Aryan Brotherhood. But he's a friend to this day. And that tells me that we write off people at our own peril. I'm a better person, better human being, a richer person, because I've got to know that client, and we've become friends. So I'm with you on that one, Bonnie.
Vida?
I don't want to sound like a broken record, but I think one of the things you'll find among people who've been criminal defenders for a long time is that there aren't cases that they won't do. True public defenders take whatever cases are assigned to them, and you end up, liking most of your clients, regardless of what they're accused of or what they've actually done. I've certainly had clients that I did not like personally, and I've certainly had clients where I didn't like what they did. But when you're in that room and it's just you and your client and they need you, you're gonna find some way to connect with them. And they're gonna find some way to connect with you, and just a human being in that room who's, in a bad spot, and you're gonna be able to relate to at least that part of your life.
Abby?
So I love everything everybody said, and I just wanna say what they said, because they were so eloquent. I've never refused a court appointment, not as a public defender, not as somebody who takes court appointments ever since. I consider myself basically a lifelong public defender, just in fancier digs these days. But some cases test me. And I would say the ones that test me most are representing alleged racists and alleged rapists. So that, serious felony sex offenses and hate crimes. Test me. Those are not the kind of cases that drew me to do this work. It's very helpful that I represent only the poor accused. I mean, I really am a lifelong indigent criminal defense lawyer, and the fact of representing poor people is a really important draw for me. So even though those cases may test me, there's a whole lot, I agree with you. You just peel away the crime and there's a person there. There's a story, there are reasons. People don't do things for no reason. I would say the other cases that test me are cross-examining, especially sympathetic, alleged victims. I think in the moment, even though I'm absolutely my client's advocate, and you can't be saddled with doubt, by the time you're in trial and you're cross-examining, you better not be saddled with all kinds of mixed feelings and hand-wringing. You can't do that. That would be, frankly, a violation of every kind of ethical standard and just the kind of ethos of what it means to stand up for another human being in need. One of the things I teach students and postgraduate fellows to say to clients when we're appointed to represent them is, I represent you. And so you can't let those feelings get in the way, but I'm being honest with you here, that's not my favorite part of the job, is to cross-examine and oftentimes do more than raise doubt, make into a liar somebody who, when the dust is settled and I'm away from the courtroom, I would acknowledge is a sympathetic and truthful and wounded person.
I'm having a memory of Abby's predecessor at the Prettyman program. He represented a guy who had been charged with 8 different rapes and had already gotten a couple of life sentences and was going away forever anyway. And so he just kind of, for the entertainment value, decided to go to trial on all of them. Yeah, he wasn't doing anything else. And this guy was not the person charged with crimes, the lawyer was my boyfriend at the time. And I remember coming in and he just had his head in his hands and I said, what had happened? And we're in maybe rape number 5 or something. And they had put a suit on the client, and he was in a suit, and they gave him a pad of paper to take notes. This guy was rude, crude, and not taking a lot of notes. But during jury selection, he wrote a note and he handed it to my friend, and the note said, "I'd really like to fuck juror number 8. And that night he just thought, you know, the endless hours of time that I could be giving to other clients, and you know, that was the big test. So what about innocent clients? Are they harder? Are they easier? Do you ever ask them if they're innocent or whether they did it? Talk to me, Elon.
Never ask. Absolutely never ask. I mean, I never ask
And
my
don't
client.
Ask, Stu. That's my answer.
Well, when I first meet a client, you know, I just say, look, I'm here for you. I'm going to represent you. I'm going to work really hard. You don't know that yet, but you're going to see that I'm going to work really hard for you. Because, you know, I was public defender, and so they didn't ask for me, and I felt it was my, you know, they didn't know who I was, you know. And eventually they would see, yes, that I was going to fight for them. But no, I never ask clients. I don't really care, as I said before, whether they're innocent or guilty. I don't. You know, I tell them, look, you know, I'm going to go out, I'm going to investigate, I'm going to see if there's a defense. I get information from them. You know, and every client's different. Some will walk in the door and tell you, oh, I did it, or I didn't do it. And so you can't treat every case, you know, the same. It's going to be different. But no, I never asked. But there are some cases where in the course of investigation you think, oh, shit, this person might be innocent, you know? And that is harder. There's no question about it. My friend Michelle Roberts, who's now a partner at Skadden, who used to be at the Public Defender Service, one of the great, great trial lawyers I've ever seen or met.
She says the same of mine.
Pardon me?
She says the same of
me. Oh, yeah. No, she doesn't. That's true, and she doesn't. And those of you who know Michelle know she would not say it. She would say, yes, I am. She would say, she is the greatest. But she used to say all the time, I hate innocent clients. That was one of her favorite phrases. I hate innocent clients. And, it, you know, you would maybe discover as you're investigating, oh, my God, maybe this person didn't do it. And, of course, that puts this extra pressure. Not that you would ever work any less hard for the clients that might be guilty, because you wouldn't. But of course, that puts that extra thing on there. But I never asked, never cared, didn't matter to me, you know, either way. I mean, I just feel like, you know, and it's sort of going back to the other question you asked. You know, and Abby talked about cross-examining people. You know, my thing is, they're going to be all right. They got the prosecutor's office, they got the police department behind them, they got the victim's assistance unit, they got the community behind them. My client is nobody but me. And you know, it's not that I'm a heartless person. If somebody said to me, you know, and it showed me a crime, of course that's a terrible crime. But when I'm representing a client, I got 100% on that client. And there's no space in my mind for dividing out sympathies to other people. My client may go to prison for the rest of his life, and I just keep thinking about that. Or go to prison for 2 years, or three, or whatever. And I keep thinking about that, and that makes me like 100% mentally, emotionally, and otherwise on that client. You know, innocent, guilty, whatever. Doesn't matter. Because even if they're guilty, I don't think they deserve to be in the criminal justice system that we have. The vast majority of clients I represent were not, yeah, there's always the case with the 8 rapes and all that. The vast majority of the clients I represent were not in that category and did not deserve, even if they'd done something bad, in my view, did not deserve to have to go to prison for the time that they would go to prison for. So I had absolutely no problem, you know, fighting really hard. Sorry, I went on.
I'm not going to make everybody answer every question. Does somebody else want to answer that question, David?
I do.
And I'm happy for everybody, too.
I do want to answer that question. Let me first say that when I was a public defender, I didn't care. Didn't ask the question, didn't care. And I worked hard, and as a civil rights lawyer now, I work hard for all my clients, guilty or alike. I don't, though, do innocence project work, with the exception of one case I'm handling right now that is really testing me. Please remember this name, and her name is Tyra Patterson. She's on Facebook. Go to Justice for Tyra, or go to her website, www, right? The website. it's justiceforthetyra.com. And I am up at night. I'm working 7 days a week to free this woman I met less than a year ago. And what drives me crazy about this case is that she was represented by 2 lawyers. She got convicted in 1994. She was 19 years old. She's been locked up for half of her life. for aggravated murder, aggravated robbery, cheated evidence. We have reinvestigated the case. It is breathtaking what her lawyers didn't do for her. She made a 911 call after this crime happened. There was a group of girls who assaulted another group. There was a robbery, and Tyra was at the scene, but she wasn't involved in it. And they didn't put the 911 call in. They said, basically, because you're a sixth grade dropout and you talk like you're from the hood, no juror is going to believe you. Well, guess what? We got six jurors this summer to give us affidavits saying, had we known about the 911 call, we never would have convicted her. Had we known that the lead government witness said somebody else did the robbery, not our client, we never would have convicted her. That keeps me up late at night, because she needs to be home. She needs to be with her family. She needs to live her life. And it's not that, I mean, when I was doing the sex offender litigation, I was up late at night too doing that work. But if I fail Tyra Patterson, she's gonna continue to be locked up. And so I've gotta keep working and working and working and working until I get her home. So yeah, it's hard, it's really hard.
You mentioned the Innocence Project. What about that, Abby? What do you think about that? I may or may not have heard of you, Tyra, about.
No, I'm gonna thank you for the opportunity to at least pay tribute this time. I admire the many accomplishments of the Innocence Projects across the country. I mean, there's just no question that the work of Innocence Projects has shed light on all of the issues that underlie not just wrongful convictions, but deep problems in our criminal justice system. So those cases have been fabulous for that reason. People now know, for example, about the problem of mistaken eyewitness identification. 75% of the DNA exonerations involve eyewitnesses who make mistakes because human memory is not perfect. People now know about the phenomenon of false confessions, which is counterintuitive for lots of people, that somebody accuser from who's innocent might be coerced into saying they did it. People understand that underlies wrongful convictions. Not to mention police and prosecutorial misconduct and defense lawyer incompetence, which David just offered as an example. So all of those things are really important contributions. You know, as a defense lawyer, though, I worry about Innocence Projects. I think, first of all, the DNA is going to dry up eventually. I mean, all of the exonerations, and there are almost 300 now, are all DNA cases. They tend to be sexual assaults or sexual assault homicides where DNA can be found. So that's going to dry up, and we're going to be left with many of the same problems. That's number one. Number two, you know, to be perfectly honest about what the work of criminal defense is, it's notwithstanding Abraham Lincoln's kind of famous saying that he only represented innocent people. It's not, by and large. Thank God. I agree with you guys. Thank God it's not, by and large, representing innocent people. You know, frankly, we live in a very sorry state of affairs if it was. If this particular Western democracy, you know, was mostly representing people who were completely innocent. So no, and I think it's important for folks to realize that criminal defense, by and large, is representing people who did something, quite often not what they're charged with, something less, oftentimes something considerably less. But it's, you know, why I prefer to describe what I do for a living as the Guilty Project, not the Innocence Project, just to be perfectly clear about what it is. And I think if especially the, you know, younger folks in the audience, if you're thinking about, you know, what kind of work you want to do, you should, everything everybody's saying here is really very profound, because they're kind of expressing what it means to do the work, that you represent people who've made mistakes.
Anybody else want to answer that one? Either of those?
Can I just add something to just drive home what Abby said?
Absolutely.
On this Tyra Patterson case, we're in a clemency posture, and I'm sitting talking with the lawyer for the governor, and the Innocence Project has made getting Tyra out so much harder, because there's no DNA. There's not going to be any DNA. And he's expecting indisputable evidence of innocence, and he's going to ignore the six polygraphs that were taken from all the witnesses saying she didn't do it, the 911 call, the transcript, because there's no DNA. So it's raised the burden that we've got to show, and it's hard. It's really hard.
And not to mention that there's only, the police only collect DNA in the more serious cases because it's expensive to test the stuff. So where does that leave the vast majority of criminal defendants who are usually charged with misdemeanors? Doesn't leave them anywhere in terms of having to prove their innocence, which I think is another thing the Innocence Projects have done, is sort of shifted the burden a bit on the defense to uncover evidence when, of course, it's the government's burden.
So have there been clients that have been especially challenging for you? We all know that they can't name names because that would be wrong, a breach of confidentiality. But without naming names, what was it about those cases that made them challenging? Aman?
So I had one client that I represented with Michelle Robbins. I was a junior counsel. And this client was charged with felony murder, and first degree premeditated murder. Actually, it was a case where I got the very worst jury note that I ever got from a jury, which was they came back and said, Your Honor, do we have to choose between felony murder and first degree premeditated murder, or can we find him guilty of both? Well, the judge told us to stay here, it won't be long. And it wasn't. That client was challenging. In fact, when we first started representing that client, Michelle said, there's going to be a 23-110, which is the statute about ineffectiveness. She said, no matter what we do with this client, if he's found guilty and given the weight of the evidence, we thought there was a good chance that would happen, there's going to be one. And there was one, and it was cool. He had to do whatever he had to do to get out. But he was an interesting character. I'll just tell one story about him. He was out at Lorton during the pretrial phase. He had other matters. And so we had to go out there to visit him, and I swear to God, I'm not making this up. We called to make an appointment to see him, and whoever was on the phone said that I'll call him Mr. Crawford. Mr. Crawford can't see you on that day. He's busy. This was my client. So he was like, a staff at Lord, I have no idea how he was. But yeah, he was a difficult client for many, many different reasons, you know, just large and in charge. But I have to say that, you know, in terms of difficult clients, the clients that I found were sort of the easiest to work with the exception of this one client who was just such a taskmaster, were the clients that were charged with more serious offenses. I don't know if this was just coincidence, but my misdemeanor clients were the ones that drove me crazy. I think it was a lot of them, you know, had like, you know, was sort of like the client that you were describing in your story, Abby, you know, had mental health issues, had, you know, couldn't show up for things, were difficult, kind of just did, or like the client that Peter Crownhammer, who's now a judge, who used to be a PDS, had a client who was charged with a misdemeanor, and went to Peter was sitting there interviewing him at PDS one day, and the client just hauled up, punched Peter right in the face, out of nowhere. I mean, just because he was mentally ill, and it just came out of nowhere. So, yeah, I mean, most of the time, it's sort of like the difficulties that bring them to the criminal justice system sometimes make it hard. They're charmed, you know, you love them to death, but it's the little tiny things that sometimes make it hard. Again, none of these issues have anything to do with anything they were charged with, because, as I said before, that didn't matter.
David, you got one?
Well, my most difficult story isn't about, it's not a personality issue, it's not where we clash. It's actually a client that I was really close to and had a lot of affection for. I was representing him in a prisoner rights case, and he's on death row, and he wanted to have religious meals before his execution. He was scheduled to be executed last June. And when I first met him, he said, you are not to talk to my capital lawyer. Period. I'm like, but I've got to, because I don't want to step on their toes and the representation that they're doing. I don't care. I want to die. I don't want to have any contact with them. I forbid you. And that was difficult. And I actually listened to him. And I think listening to him saved his life, because we developed a lot of trust. And 6 weeks out from the execution, I went to him and I told him that me and my students, I'm also a law professor at Sam and Chase College of Law. I told him that
a rival school.
And I told him that we loved him, and he started crying, and he said that you know, he would let us work with his capital team. But then he said, and this is all out in public, so I'm not preaching any confidence, he then said, but you just need to know that it's not gonna do any good because the CIA wants to execute you. So that became the basis that stopped the execution, because he was mentally ill that he didn't know why he was being executed. We came within 14 hours of losing him that we were able to get Governor Kasich to stop it. But that's really hard, because if you want to be a client-centered lawyer, what does that mean? And particularly when you have some reason to think that the client is mentally ill, and when the stakes are high. So that was something that was hard. And I'm sure there are a lot of capital lawyers who would want to spit in my face for how I handled that, but I think it was actually, it turned out to be right. Whether it was the right decision to make, it turned out to be right. But that was hard.
Vida?
I'll just note that what Dave's talking about is another huge problem in our criminal justice system, which is that a huge proportion of our clients are mentally ill or mentally retarded. And it poses additional challenges. I mean, obviously there's the culpability issues, but the fact that we have more people in our criminal justice system with mental illness than we do in mental health institutions should really be troubling to everybody. And I'd say, sure, that's probably are some of our most difficult clients who are mentally ill, because it's hard to have conversations with them where you're actually exchanging information and doing what lawyers are there to do, which is do what our clients want to do. Like, you're having a conversation with someone who just wants to talk about, you know, some clearly delusional thing. That makes it really difficult. I'll also say that sometimes now that I'm not in the public defender service anymore and at Georgetown, we sometimes take cases for people who under the guidelines could afford an attorney but really can't afford an attorney. Sometimes those people can be a little more entitled than some of our other clients and not very polite to us. Do I like that? No. But I'm still bite your hardest.
Interesting. Yeah. So I would say 30 plus years of being a criminal defense lawyer, I can count on less than one hand the number of clients I really didn't like or didn't get along with. That's very different from the number of prosecutors and or judges. And I think if Monroe Friedman was here, he would say the following to you all. He would say, as you contemplate the practice of law, you should understand that you may be called upon to represent people who, out of sheer greed, will hurt and even kill other people. And if you can't handle it, you should not go into corporate law.
One more question, because I want to really open it up to the crowd. What do you say to people, especially young people or not so young people who are law students, who want to make an impact on law or society? How is representing individuals accused of or convicted of crime contributing to social justice or human rights? What represent individuals instead of doing impact litigation or policy work to really change the criminal justice system? Who would like to go first?
I'll say that's a hard question. I do think that there's really good work to be done when you're working for, you know, something like the ACLU. Racial Justice Project, where they do a lot of criminal cases. So I do think that there's lots of other good work besides the work we do, which is direct representation. But I will say that when you are working on behalf of a single individual, it really does empower you as the attorney to fight for that person. But, you know, the individual cases can also uncover things that lead to bigger things. So you never know what a particular case is going to shed light on. It may be through your investigation that you find out a particular police officer is involved in some wrongdoings. I mean, you may find out that a police officer has lied about something and you have the videotape to show it. So you can have a bigger impact than just for your particular client. And then obviously if you do this for a long time, you end up having a lot of clients and end up having an impact on a lot of people's lives.
So I would say, you know, I agree with Vida. Individual cases can sometimes turn up there. I'm thinking of the Judge Robert Wilkins, who's now in the U.S. District Court, District of Columbia, and hopefully soon will be on the
circuit.
Hopefully, represented a client, but ended up challenging D.C.'s stalking law at the time. This was years ago, and getting it changed because of representation of that individual client uncovered that. But that is going to be rare. You know, you are representing individual clients, and my answer to that is, you know, I don't try to go around and tell each student, you need to be a public defender. You know, there is so much good work out there that needs to be done. There's policy impact work that needs to be done on both the civil and criminal side. There's individual representation that needs to be done, you know, on both the criminal and civil side. And, you know, this work right here is not for everybody. You have to get a little bit crazy in a good way to do this work. You know, I mean, there's good crazy in this thing. You guys know what I mean. So it's not for everybody. Right? But if it's for you, there is no better work. You know, when students come to me and say, I don't know if I can do something, but I don't sit there and try to talk to them. I'm like, well, let's talk about what you do want to do. So it's not work for everybody, but if it's something that you think you want to do, there is no better work. I mean, to me, you know, hearing the words not guilty from a jury, you know, we used to say this all the time, the sweetest, two sweetest words in the English language is what we used to say when we celebrate the trial chief's office at PDS as we raised our drink. I didn't drink before. But it's no better feeling, you know. I love being a law professor. I see some of my students, former students, in the room today. I'm happy to see them. I love what I do, and I hope I'll be doing this for the rest of my life. But honestly, to me, the most important work that I've ever done or will do is this. I mean, it just, I feel that way, and I love being in the position now to teach and inspire students who want to do this work. And other good work, you need you to do all the work. So I wouldn't try to make that justification.
You also never be bored. That's the really great thing about this job, is that you will always be entertained. You have great stories to tell people, and you will always wake up with a purpose.
So I think it is social justice work and human rights work. I think it's the human rights issue of our time. We are all in the District of Columbia, where 1 in 2 young African-American men between the ages of 18 and 35 are under the control of the criminal justice system. We still, notwithstanding Eric Holder's recent remarks, and I hope he means them, I hope that change is coming, but we incarcerate more than 2 million people in this country. We spend more on incarcerating people in many states than we do on higher education. I think it's shameful. And so representing people, I agree with Angela, and I have to acknowledge that it's not for everyone, but if you think you have the heart and soul of a defender, and I actually would urge you all to try it on, because I've had students at the clinic who come in and they're a little ambivalent about it. They've got their questions about certain kinds of cases. Inevitably, they do a superb job. Inevitably, it's incredibly meaningful, satisfying, challenging, interesting. Wrenching, but also really fun. So if you think that there is a defender in you, I think you should try it on. And I have to tell you, I think we're going to look back on this time in history stunned at what this country did to our poorest citizens. We put them in cages. So don't be thinking that it's not about social justice representing individuals accused of crime, especially poor people accused of crime.
Let's have your question. Ed?
Yeah. What if you have a client that tells you a long story, and then you investigate the other witnesses, and you find out that almost everything your client told you was a lie? And
what if you have a client? You lost.
And the lies all add up to this person that seems to be definitely guilty. How do you handle it?
You come up with a new theory for the case that your client gave you. Unfortunately, it happens a lot. Our clients don't have much of a reason at all to trust us. We're this lawyer that was foisted upon us, upon them. They didn't pick us. They don't have any reason to trust us. We're strangers to them. And so it's not unusual for the first story that your client tells you to not, you know, necessarily be the truth. And so you've got to do your own investigation, and you know, client's probably not going to testify under those circumstances, but you know, you're going to still represent them and still fight hard for them if they want to go to trial.
And they might wind up testifying.
And they might.
They might.
They might.
I've had clients tell me things before because they thought their understanding of the law meant they should say this to me when in fact, you know, what they had to say was terrible, and you know, you come up with a new theory. And you go hard with the new theory, and you don't judge, and you don't make the client feel like you know, they burned a bridge with you. You just can't do that, and you just gotta keep going. Just as if I would want somebody to keep going hard for me if I was in a desperate situation and came up with some bullshit, because I was scared.
It's a technical term.
I'd want lawyer to fight for me as hard as possible.
Yeah, and I mean, clients, just like government witnesses, our clients sometimes don't remember things the same way, right? I mean, just because your client told you something one day and then tells you something the other day, you're not there to judge what is the truth. It's not your role. Your role is to be, you know, this adversarial system in theory works. You know, you have a prosecutor on one side, you have a defense, supposedly this judge in the middle, justice is supposed to emerge. That's the theory. It never works out quite that way, but you're not there to judge your client, to judge what's the truth, what's not the truth. You're there to put on the best defense possible. And government witnesses tell different stories all the time, and they shove prosecutors, put them on the stand. That's how we get to impeach them with their prior inconsistent statements to the grand jury and to police department. And there are reasons why. Oh, their memory failed. Oh, they didn't tell the truth at first because they were scared. There's all kinds of reasons for that. You can't get in the business of judging that.
So it's like a variation on that famous line from Annie Hall. Of course he lied to me. Who else is he going to lie to? I think there's a certain amount of lawyer vanity that you kind of have to get rid of in this work. And kind of, you know, it is about truth, not about truth. I take that kind of thing personally. I don't blame my clients for not trusting me. You know, frankly, think about it. The court-appointed lawyer sent by the very same system that is arrested and is prosecuting this person. You know, how do they know? And you know, quite often... people think that most of our clients protest their innocence all the time. The truth is, since most people end up in the lower criminal courts, they don't. Mostly our clients say, can I plead guilty right now, this second, before any investigation or motions are filed, just to get it over with. I mean, really, that's much more of a problem is people's, because they get so beaten down, they think they're not entitled to any representation or any kind of process, I think is a much worse problem.
Absolutely.
David?
So I'm curious, you guys are really the elite and the ones who have been in the DC public defender system, and yet you look across the country and you read a book like Amy Bach's Ordinary Injustice and you realize how bad the quality of representation is really across the board. And I know there are programs, David, I know you're on the faculty of Gideon's Promise, this idea of creating a generation of lawyers who really do take the same attitude and approach that happens at Neighbor Defender Service, DC Public Defender Service. So can you talk a little bit about what happens more generally and what happens to these terrific idealistic lawyers who go into programs that are used to processing people and not providing the zealous representation that all of you were describing?
Those idealistic lawyers who go off to public defenders that are not the ones considered the elite public defenders, they get squashed like bugs if they're not plugged into a program like Gideon's Promise. John Rapping is a genius, and used to be at PDS and started Gideon's Promise, which used to be the Southern Public Defender Training Center. And what it does is it takes young public defenders in the South who are in offices that are under-resourced, that don't have great training, where the culture is anything but client-centered. In fact, the culture is more judge-centered and prosecutor-centered. And it equips them with the tools to resist. And it's making a huge difference. It's making a huge difference in terms of the attitude of these young lawyers, and they believe that they can win more of their cases. Are they going to win them all? No. Do they have the same resources as PDS has? No. But it's making progress.
So I got to tell
you when
you're finished. I didn't mean to.
Okay. I just want to say, you know, when I came, we had it easy at PDS. And,
we whined and complained, but we didn't know how good it was.
I came to Cincinnati, Ohio. I wanted to continue being a public defender, and the reason I'm not to this day is at that time I met with the chief, and he said, I asked him how many cases we have. Well, I don't know how many cases we have. It's in the hundreds per lawyer. And I was like, okay, tell me about how investigation works. Well, we have these two investigators for the entire office, and they're former police officers, and if they think that your client may have a claim of innocence, they'll investigate. I'm like, I can't do this. I just can't. And I feel like I'm a coward in many respects for not stepping up and doing that work anyway. I'm glad I'm doing what I did now. It happened all for a reason. I think I'm doing some good work to try and help change that. But when you had lawyers in the Hamilton County office who were spending an hour and 40 minutes per case on average, from the beginning, meeting the client, all the way through trial, that's not PDS, but that's not the way anybody should be treated in the criminal justice system. And that's the way it is in most places across this country.
I mean, even the NLADA guidelines, which are the standards for criminal offense lawyers, is 400 misdemeanor cases per year. That doesn't leave a lot of time for people to investigate cases, meet their clients, go to the jail, write motions, and actually try the case. I mean, you're talking, it comes out to about 7 hours, and those are the guidelines. And that's if someone only takes, you know, works 50 hours a week and only takes 2 weeks of vacation a year, works every holiday. I mean, it's ugly out there.
David mentioned John Rapping. At UDC, 18 months after Hurricane Katrina, 40 of us went down to New Orleans to help out during an alternative spring break. It's been about 10 days. And four of us went to work with John Rapping, the public defender down there. It's different there. It's a whole different thing. We were sitting around the office. They had, it's 18 months after Katrina. We walked 40 people out of jail who had already been locked up and served more time than they would have had they been convicted and given the maximum sentence. We walked 40 people out like that during our week, okay? Four of us. I came across a case where there was just palpably, from the police officer's report, clearly no probable cause. Just, you know, oops. And the second police officer had erased to write the identical language as the first police officer that was killed. So we did a motion to suppress. We go in for this motion to suppress. First thing that happens is one of the lawyers with us, one of your former colleagues at PDS, Janice Washington, 6 foot tall, African, speaking about large and in charge. Associate dean with me for many years, wonderful, wonderful lawyer. First of all, the marshals tried to move her off because she had to be a relative of one of the defendants. Didn't occur to him it could be a lawyer. Just to set the scene. Anyway, then the lawyer announces the motion to suppress, and the prosecutor says, "Motion to suppress? Y'all not feel blindsided? And finally, you know, he has to proceed. You know, it's a constitutional thing. The evidence is coming out. And the judge at the end of the day grants the motion to suppress. You'd think we won a giant felony. You know, it changed the way those lawyers went crowd gathered to see this motion to suppress tangible evidence. You know, it was unbelievable. Anyway, yeah, no, it's different now.
Shelley, can I just quickly also put in a plug for Gideon's Army, a movie that's on HBO right now that shows these lawyers who were in that Gideon's Promise training program and shows the difference that it makes and what difference young lawyers can make in communities that have generally bad representation. And these lawyers stand in the face of that storm and they make a difference. So worth seeing that movie. It's very powerful.
It's actually not playing on HBO now, but if you have HBO Go, you can watch it. However, on October 18th, write that down, it's going to be showing for free over at the rival law school, American University. We're having a conference, and on the evening of October 18th, we're showing that film, and Don Porter, who's the creator of the film, is going to be there and be on a panel along with one of the public defenders featured in the film, and they're going to speak about their experience after the film. So, you know, contact me, and you know, I'm at AU Angela Davis. Email me if you want more information about that. I'll send it to you.
And if you send it to me, I'll also send it out.
Thank you.
That's Broderick at UDC.edu. Yes. And we're going to go two more, and then I'm going to give you a chance to buy the book. Then the goodies, right? Okay. Yes.
All right. So thank you very much for being here. First of all, you all are talented lawyers. I am familiar with Mr. Singleton, and you know, we really would like to thank you for gracing our school. Being here and everything. And so another part of you know, the wins are really great, but it's really the losses that are the toughest part. So how do you, and there are different kinds of losses, obviously, plea agreements, and then there are going to trial and losing on the face. So how is it that you really deal with the tough losses?
I think you just gotta keep going. You gotta find a way to, the way I look at losses is that, and it's not always the case, I mean, as a public defender, certainly if somebody gets sentenced to life without parole and you've gone through all of the appeals and the post-conviction stuff to try and get it out, it's tough to deal with that. It's just tough. That's not what I do on a day-to-day basis now, and when we lose cases, we just we take some time to lick our wounds and then we figure out how we're going to get past it, how we're going to get around it or over it or through it. That's certainly what happened in our sex offender litigation is, you know, we had setback after setback after setback in the beginning, but you just got to find a way to keep going. And it may be that you rely on faith to get you there. It may be that you rely on a whole bunch of really smart people who you pull in to help you brainstorm. I'm a big believer in brainstorming. You can't do this work effectively on your own and alone. And you've got to wind up being a solo practitioner. You've got to find a network of people to brainstorm with. It can be your support when things are really difficult. But that's how I've dealt with it, is that I refuse to admit that I've lost. It just may be a temporary setback that is going to eventually get overcome. And, you know, that's when we came within 14 hours of losing Abdul Akal, and we got that notice from the Supreme Court that they denied our stay, our Ohio Supreme Court, we just said, okay, we're going to have to work all night. And luckily, the governor stepped in and granted a reprieve at the last bit. But you just got to keep going, you know, find a way.
So you could probably tell from the excerpt from my chapter that I read that I don't take losses well. I mean, that was a little, you know, juvenile client with, you know, facing 2 years at Oak Hill, and I couldn't handle it. That was my first client. I got a little tougher as time went on. But you're right, there are different kinds of losses. And so one thing people should know that in this country, 95% of all criminal cases are resolved by way of a guilty plea, right? People look at television and see other trials going on. Now, there's a lot of guilty pleas going on, a very small percentage of them are actual trials. So, you know, victory is, there are different kinds of victories, and so getting a really good plea offer for a client and getting probation for a client, those can be seen as victories too. Everything is relative. But when it is a really, really hard loss, I agree with David, you keep fighting. I mean, we had, and they still have, a great appellate division at PBS led by the great Jimmy Klein standing up there in the back. So we would just go to Jimmy and say, okay, Jimmy, we got to win this whole appeal. And he would work miracles when he could. You know, you fight on different levels for clients. But, you know, you have to put it in perspective, and you keep going. I mean, you keep going with that client as far as you can. When the client's locked up, you don't forget the client. You keep doing what you can for them. But you keep on keeping on because there's so many other clients out there, and they need you too. And so you can't sort of fall apart. There are different things that you can do, and everybody has their own little thing that they do to give themselves. I mean, people would know when I was at PDS when I was with my James Cleveland CD and turn it up real loud. For those of you who don't know, that's a gospel singer. You know, that's what like kept me going. Everybody has their thing that keeps them going, but you have to keep going.
Sally, and then I'm gonna pick somebody over here, Cheryl. Okay, we're done. Sal.
I read the book. All the essays are really remarkable, and I think it should be required reading, is my own opinion, for all incoming law students. Whatever they decide to do with their career, it's a really great window into how the system works, why you do the work that you do. You know, I said to Abby, I don't know why the Magna Carta section was in the last chapter, because I didn't realize the Magna Carta has a whole, several sentences on the right to be tried before a jury of your peers and to be accused under a rule of law. And so that's pretty significant. But one thing I noticed on reading the essays is that almost everybody who contributed to the book is interested in indigent criminal defense. So I do consumer work, as Shelley noted, and some of the time we see scam artists who steal people's money with no remorse, who've had all the advantages, and my feeling is I want to throw the book at those people. So one of the questions I have for you all is you've chosen a certain course, and I think I understand that, but I want to ask you, you know, what about the Whitey Bulgers, or the Bernie Madoffs, or the Jack Abramoffs? Does the calculus change for you when you're not dealing with somebody who hasn't?
Or Zimmerman.
And I was going to ask the George Zimmerman question, actually, because I know for the African-American community, it's considered to be a huge miscarriage of justice that he had a fabulous defense. So if you would take a moment to just, you know, delve into that question or give us your thoughts.
Rich, white-collar criminal.
I'm going to sidestep the Zimmerman issue because I think that is a more complicated basis from a criminal defense perspective. But I will say that I don't know if I'm unique in this or not. I will say that I think a lot of defense attorneys' opinions would be different. But I actually really felt bad for like Bernie Madoff and Martha Stewart when they were going to jail at the age of 60. And I think that comes from knowing what prison in the United States is like. It's horrible. It is really just disgusting. Once you've been to a prison, you kind of can't imagine anyone having to go there, no matter what they've done. I have a friend who's a criminal defense lawyer in England, and they get high tea at 4 o'clock, and you get to wear your own clothes, and you can wear...
In prison?
Yeah, it depends on your security classification, but you can like wear your own clothes, and women can wear jewelry. I mean, it is like a different, people are treated like human beings, like they still can contribute to the world, and they'll get out someday, so let's not take out all their humanity. So I think it depends on the case and it depends on the person. But I personally still feel bad for most people who have to go to prison.
For me, it's all about representing poor people. That's why I did the work. I mean, I talk about it in my chapter. I'm from the South. It was about representing poor people. I thought I was going to do civil rights. I thought I was going to be a civil rights lawyer. I feel like I was one eventually, but I didn't realize this is what I would be doing. But for me, it was about representing poor people and people of color. And that's what it's about for me. I think Martha Stewart, Bernie Madoff, all of them, they deserve to have lawyers. Would I ever represent them? Never. Because I just don't really care. I didn't care that Martha Stewart went to jail. I just feel horrible. This is the thing, don't misunderstand. Prison is horrible for everybody. But I knew she would get out and do fine. Look at her now. She's doing better now than ever. I knew prison was not going to hurt her. Some people commit crimes and they just come out of it and nothing ever happens to them. They rise like phoenixes, and it has to do with class, it has to do with race, and good for them. But do I want to represent them? Hell no. It's not about that for me. So good for them, but it's just not for me. And I'm going to have a lawyer, but would I do it? Not for all the money in the world, just not me.
You know, I also do what I do because I care about representing poor people and mostly people of color. I think I'm more aligned with Reed on this than Angela, but it's, I mean, I think everybody's got a story, and does that mean that I should necessarily be the one representing them? I guess not, but if I had a clone and that clone wanted to make a little money, could that clone be fired up to represent Martha Stewart or Bernie Madoff? Yes.
My clone can't represent.
And you know what? I can represent George Zimmerman, absolutely. And I, you know, I know that a lot of people would look at me and say, "How could you say that?" I feel. Imagine having the feeling like the whole country hates you and wants to see you go away for the rest of your life. That's something I could sign up to do because that person needs a friend in that tough time. And that's what we do as public defenders. Yes, we do it for poor people who can't afford to have representation, but I want to be that person's friend. And does that mean that I like the acts? And you know, what I think happened in the case, and do I like what happened to Trayvon? Of course I don't. Of course I don't. But when somebody needs a friend, that's what we are to our public defender clients. And some of the clients that we represent as public defenders have power in their own communities of poor people, and they wreak it. And I had an aunt who used to live up in Harlem, and she was terrified of the gangbangers in the neighborhood. In fact, she carried a gun because she was afraid of them. And those folks had a lot of power over her, and I would sign up to represent them and be happy about it. So yeah, I could represent Georgetown.
Sherman, now I want you to know I'm calling on a guy who often wears a
Yankee hat.
Sherman, you're up.
I was wondering about grievances you all had or encountered in situations where a client filed or threatened to file a grievance against you, and how that impacted your approach to the criminal defense.
And if you haven't, try being a dean.
I missed the first part.
Yes, sent you to the bar.
Not to the bar, but that client I mentioned earlier, who Michelle said he's going to file a 23-110, basically a claim saying that you were ineffective. I was not at all upset with him. Actually, do write about that in my essay as well. I wasn't upset with him because he got sentenced, to life. And he had to do everything in his power, to get out. And so I had no problem, when I was called to testify, I said what I had to say, but I wasn't trying to say too much, quite frankly, to help the government. The government was representing me. I wasn't so comfortable with that. I told the truth because I was, under oath, and so I told the truth, but I wasn't trying to pour it on to make myself look good, like I was the great glory or anything like that, because he had to do whatever he could do to get out, and I said that to that. In fact, his father was in the courtroom at the time and was kind of embarrassed because he had watched the trial. He knew me and Michelle did everything for this client. And so he even went up to me and apologized. I was like, oh no, don't worry about it. I'm not upset with him. He's got to do what he's got to do. So no, I didn't have a problem with that. That was just my own personal story under those circumstances. Now there might be other circumstances that would be different. But.
No, my Tucker Carrington, one of the contributing authors in the book, tells a story about a client who wrote a letter, was very unhappy with Tucker's representation, and wrote to him addressing the letter to Tucker Carrington, attorney at law.
I also just say, I just think that people should, that stigma should be taken away from people, because I think there's not a single one of us, there's not a single defense attorney in the world who has done a perfect job on a case. And I think that good attorneys recognize that and are willing to tell the truth about the mistakes they've made. It's a hard job and you can't be perfect at it, and I wish more lawyers would fall on their sword and admit when they made a mistake on behalf of
the client. Amen to that. In this Tyra Patterson case I mentioned, one of the lawyers did stand up and said, we should have found a way to deal with some of the evidence, and we should put the 911 call in. The other lawyer was fighting tooth and nail to defend what he did. Yeah. And I don't like to write people off, but I don't really feel it with him. I mean, he's trying to protect his own ass rather than help walk out a woman who's been locked up for 19 years. So if this ever happens to you, and it probably will at some point, somebody complains, just know where it's coming from, as Angela says, and fall on your sword if you need to, and be truthful. Don't lie, but just be truthful.
So I know this is the end, but I want to say one last thing, and not to obsess about Martha Stewart, but here's the thing that I just whispered. This is what I was talking about when I should have been listening. I guess the thing that bothered me about her so much is that she came out of prison, and I fully expected her to come out and be an advocate, at least in some small way, for people in prison. Say something about it. Give some little piece of that all the $1 million that you have to David's organization or to Gideon's problem. So, and she is just pretending like nothing ever happened to her. So if I ever met her, that's the first thing I would ask her. I mean, what? Don't forget the women. She talked for a minute, I think, after she got out about the women she met in there. Now it seems like it's like disappeared from her history. I guess that angers me, so I'm sorry, Jim.
Now, I'd like to use that as an opening, because David Singleton, if anybody has any means whatsoever, he's running this fantastic organization, the Ohio Justice and Policy Center in Cincinnati, Ohio, in the middle of the country, and has single-handedly, in my view, he's a hero of mine, he's really created change. So if you can if any of you can find it in your hearts or in your pockets to make a contribution, his organization is going to keep doing amazing work. I just wanted to give that little shout out.
And I second that. Go to his website and see some of the amazing work that he's doing out there, and I hope that you will be able to contribute.
contributed as well.
He didn't ask us to do this.
No, he didn't. It's a lesson for y'all. For those of you who are in law school, you know, there are more than a couple of public defender offices in the country. There are more than a couple of places to practice law. You can actually make an enormous difference in any number of places just by being a good one. Shelley's story, just by filing a motion. You know, you can shame the rest of the bar. They'll start filing motions. But it's just wrong. You know, you hear, you know, everybody takes out their violin, there's just too many lawyers in this. No, there may be too many lawyers doing certain kind of work in certain kind of places. But boys, they're in need for really excellent, devoted lawyers in all parts of the country. So really take a page from David on that one.
Well, on this, thank you so much. And I hope you will line up and let them autograph the book for you and purchase it.
Is it?
Yeah.